very exciting. The question or the issue that I would like to talk a little bit with you about concerns, there's a sort of tension in this, in work in this area between the notion, on the one hand, we're told that to be autonomous, a system has to exhibit this kind of interactional asymmetry. So the system with the autonomy has to have the upper hand over the environment in terms of some ability to modulate the way that it's coupled with the environment. But on the other hand, in your thesis, we're told that the autonomy of a cognitive system is not located within the agent itself, but is somehow shared with the environment in the form of this kind of sensorimotor coupling. And you use an interesting device to help kind of resolve this tension, this notion of a dynamic core. So that idea comes out of neuroscience, where it's used to describe things that are wholly inside the head of an agent, right? Some neural dynamics that are going on, and they are the dynamic core that is somehow responsible for the behavior. But what you want to do is take that dynamic core and bring elements of the environment into it, and yet maintain this asymmetry. So on the one hand, with one hand, you bring the environment into the core, and you say the environment can be a kind of first class participant in the autonomy of the agent, but with the other hand, you say no, the environment has to remain a second class participant because it must be dominated by the agent. The agent can't be subjugated by the environment. So I guess I just wanted to hear a little bit more about how you see that tension and whether the environment can really be a part of this dynamic core.
Okay. Yeah, right, yes. This is one of the main themes I want to explore, how to resolve. We propose that this interaction of terrain and environment is constitutive of the kind of autonomous agency that arrives. And how I see it, I think that this tension between being coupled with an environment and maybe not being able to distinguish what is environment, what is agent, if it's an autonomous entity, and being separated from the environment, unable to stand up or to establish an asymmetrical relation with the environment, should be found in the different scales of description of the system. I think that if we define these different levels, and for example, at one level we can have the system and the environment as material different entities, but we can have a higher level material, higher level relational levels of description. And precisely the idea of a dynamic core, which as it is normally defined in terms of, for example, DSC complexity or other indicators of complexity, what tries to depict is the relation between these low levels of description and these high levels of description of systems that can be integrated but can have their own differentiated dynamics at the low level. And what I think is that the emergence of these higher level patterns that are relational at the end, they comprise the relations between the different neurons, but also the relations between the environment. These are the ones that can modulate the interactions at the lower level. So in that sense, I think you cannot have both. You cannot have the system and the environment and the two connected. Instead, that these things happen at different scales. So at one scale, we can see that how the interaction between the system and environments is very directional. At the other scale, maybe this direction is reverse, or this is modulating how different kinds of the game takes place. So I will say that the agent is modulating its relation with the environment in an asymmetrical way, but if you are truly in a sensorimotor interaction, the higher order patterns that modulate this copying are going to be relational. I think that in this way is how this tension may be solved.
Can I quickly follow up? So you use this nice example in the thesis of a woman who is going to work, she cycles and she can sometimes take a quick journey, but it's on a busy road, or she can take the slightly slower journey, but it's through a park and it's nicer. And some days she chooses one, and some days she chooses the other, and she is exercising some autonomy in that choice. But the environment has some role to play. Today the traffic is very busy, or today the weather is terrible. So one might imagine that over the course of a year, there is a very long scale sort of dynamic that is in the environment. The weather gets colder gradually, it gets rainier, and she starts to pick the quick route more often. In your simulations though, the environment doesn't have any of these long timescale intrinsic dynamics. The colored lights appear at random for the duration of the trial, and then next time they appear at random somewhere else. So the longest timescale dynamics in the simulation belong to the agent, because it's the only thing that really lasts in the world. If you change your simulations to include long-term unfolding intrinsic environmental dynamics, do you think that you would find another arrow in your cycle, a slow modulation from the environment into the agent? And would you be happy with that, or would that mean, is that subjugation of the agent by the environment, or is that just multiple scales of asymmetry?
Okay, yeah, like following the example, I think, yeah, in this case, you have the cyclist, you have the environment, and clearly there's a distinction of the agent which chooses to the route to take every day. But there is this other level of accumulated relational processes of how I go use this path, and this happens, and there's these weather conditions, and you have this higher level of relations between agent and environment that is able to modulate the agent environment interaction. In the same way, what I think in the agent is of course much more simple, and the environment is it only changes in the position of the lights, but the long scale dynamics that happens take place in the behavioral preferences of the agent. The agent will go to one light for 10 trials, then go to the other for 20 trials, and this is not only happening inside the agent, it happens because particular positions of the lights that coincide and disrupt the internal configuration, so it's a relational level in that sense. And I think that that what is interesting is that the modulation of the agent, which in this case we analyze it, we identify in the relation between the synapses of the agent, which store all this information about how I went to that light and then I choose the other, and then like all this history of interactions, this model is capturing all this history of interactions captured by the synapses and the environment in this circle there. And in that sense, I think that this relational domain of modulation is found there. And for the question of if we had a lower scale level of regulation of this environment, I will say that it imposes a relation of subjugation or not, depending on how much it is able to. If, for example, if the agent will choose light change the light automatically every time the season changes and it's winter, and then it will be clearly a relation of subjugation. But if the agent is influenced by this scale, but it's somehow able to maintain its preference depending on the particular history of previous interaction. For example, if I have choose this light, this other, and then the season changes, but I will keep going a little more and saying after some trials, depending on what I find, then this we could analyze with this kind of information measures whether the agent is being subjugated by this longer time scale or if it is just using them for modulating its own behavior or what, or to what extent we can. It's not, maybe it's not black or white, we can have some points in the middle and measure what's the influence of the agent and the environment.
Making the questions like the other people have made all the questions. All right, anyway, I have a lot of questions. So there are several things that I like from the thesis. One that I really appreciate is that usually people does not have a really good historical timeline of what happened in the past. In a way, builds our knowledge today. And it's very nice to see that you built a lot of ideas, very well organized, about cybernetics and all the old story. But for the same reason, I also find some gaps, and I'd like to know why is that. Some of them are very specific, some of them are more broad. For example, one of the main things that you consider clearly is interaction between an agent and the environment, and to what extent the behavioral traits of the agent, as you observe from the outside, are changed because you are interacting with some context. I have more questions about that, but one thing that I think was a very important contribution at the time was Greywater, which you actually mentioned one of his books. On brain waves, but he has the other book, which is, I think, it's the other book, Thinking by Machines, which is a book about his little turtles that go around as agents, and there actually is a lot of discussion about why, when you put the agent in the context of even a trivial thing like the home, sometimes unexpected behaviors come out. And I think there was a very interesting previous episode of that. You didn't mention that for any particular reason? Or?
Yeah, obviously I haven't read some papers from Greenwater, but I have not read that book. I choose to explore more on the question of the work of ASDIC because I was interested in mechanisms that explicitly address this modulation of its own configuration. And because we were thinking of how to model these kind of mechanisms, and that was the region because most of the space is given to this to the idea of trustability and so on. But yes, maybe that would be a nice contribution to the historical part of the.
Yeah, I think it's quite fits quite well as a precondition to that. And more generally, it could be argued that in a way people working on what you could call artificial ethology are also playing around these kind of problems. That once you put your cognitive agent in a context, then the behavioral traits that you can identify and the description you might make of the internal dynamics may be short in terms of it, having a picture of what happens in the environment. So what do you say is your contribution that makes it different or more relevant in any way? Other work in the area.
So
to rephrase what I'm saying is in a fundamental way there's a lot of work on how robots, for example, behave in a given environment, how they manage to, as embodied objects, how they manage to gather information and behave. And you have made an interesting thing, I think, which is use a very elegant model, the HKE model, HKE model, sorry, which is mathematically well known, has very well defined symmetric properties, etc. And it made the formal extension. I think that's, I found it quite interesting. Do you think it's something more than that in your contribution?
Okay, for that particular chapter. Okay. Yeah, this chapter, there's models that capture this idea of that is the behavior is different when you're embodied or not. The objective with this chapter was to have a picture of how different, we'll have a brief story about analyze how these ideas of embodiment have been applied or not in mainstream neuroscience. And then the intent of the chapter was maybe not proving something new, but to have a simple model that we can easily analyze. It's just three dimensions and we can extract the phase space and the attractors and like so it's in that sense it's more like making the contribution is more like having a very simple model in which we can precisely analyze these changes in the phase space and the difference when it's passing the couple and so on. So that, but yeah, probably there is many more models that have analyzed this difference between what this influence of the model.
Okay. There's several places you use self-organized criticality in a way as you make them a mapping. I don't know if you want to, but it's kind of a mapping of the presence of some scaling laws like monitoring noise and the assumption that you have self-organized criticality, which is, you know, for many people is something that you actually cannot do, including myself, of course. You can have intermittent behaviors, some kind of particular forms of noise that leads to scaling loss, not necessarily self-organized critical. It's important to make the point. I'm also curious about another thing. In your dissertation, you mentioned the kind of levels of agency. Specifically, talk about having sensorimotor properties or metabolic agency or social agency, etc. That to me connects very strongly with something that might be missing here, which is the evolutionary part of the story. Within evolutionary theory, we have this idea of innovation as presented in this idea of major transitions. Major transitions, to a very large extent, imply that you jump into different levels of agency. Usually, or maybe always, typically needs some new class of embodiment. Maybe they go into a membrane and you encapsulate the code, or you go into a multicellular system that in a way requires the interaction between different simpler agents. You don't use that, you don't use or mention that, which makes your approach more, one would say, more like dynamics engineering class philosophy, what you want. Is there a reason for that?
Okay, so as to the first commentary about whatever noise and supports could help me, I agree that you cannot just assume that you have a certain criticality from whatever patterns. And we have a paper which is related to the work of chapter 4, which is depends a little bit more in how we talk about self-organized criticality for the case of these agents with mesenteric plasticity. And in general, what we did was to not only detect one word of patterns, but analyze how different measures of scaling, like fractal and spectral patterns or fractal analysis, and more than that, we tested how the one-over patterns were maintained under different disruptions of the sensorimotor loop or the plastic mechanisms, and how perturbing changes in the parameters of the systems are changed with this idea of that the self-organized critical as a SOC system is a system that is able to generate these scale-free patterns without a specific coupling of the parameters. that sense, I think we talk more of synchronized ideality for this agent, and we tested to more extent the robustness of these scalars. And I think in general we try not to assume that much synchronized ideality for other chapters. Okay, so regarding the second question, I was talking before of the first chapter where we analyze this agent, which is just gets to an environment, and we then analyze the agent, which is able to modulate its own coupling with these plastic mechanisms and so on. And yes, I think it would be interesting to connect this idea of to analyze in more depth the transition from an agent which is just able to be embodied in a world to an agent which has these plastic mechanisms that we identify as modeling some form of agency of regulating the loop. And it could be interesting to connect to this other type of work on developmental or evolutionary patterns. Probably it would be interesting even to apply artificial evolution to an agent and look in different stages the behavior of the agent and see at which point, for example, this asymmetry between agent and an environment emerges, and see if it's an abrupt transition or if it's more happens in stages or what's the case here. So, yeah, I think that would be a very interesting development of the work we have presented here.
Okay. Well, that is actually ongoing work in that area. And I think it's important for several reasons. One is that if you look at agency as forms in which you, as part of the adaptation, you become more independent on the environment fluctuations, then it's I think it's an important lesson in a way to extract. And I think it's important also because if you get more independent on the environment, in a way, you just simply ready to react to whatever is statistically probable, then it might be the case that the environment is more like a statistical background from which you can actually place more relevance into how the agent reacts into that background. Because you emphasize a lot about in several places that we might be missing something really relevant about the agent features by ignoring the environment. But it could be argued that maybe the environment in a way is something you can collapse into some kind of statistical background. Yeah, I'm just thinking out loud, but I'm not expecting a question, an answer for that. One thing I will say just as a comment is that there's been in the last years kind of a renewed interest in maybe not self-organized criticality, because it's conceptually is a kind of a specific kind of way of generating avalanches, etc. But in systems poised to criticality, and in that sense, I will mention you don't mention that and you don't use that, but William Bialik and others have been using kind of a new formal approach. It's not new really, but they use the pairwise correlation between states in the system. And in a way to show that the system, beyond scaling laws and other things, has a potential capacity to really react to any kind of external signal, which is a feature you have in critical points. It is a very neat formalism. It's easy to apply, and it's been applied to many different systems, just to mention. And about the social part of the story, on the one hand, and I am sympathetic, when the 15M happened in Plaza Catalunya, my entire lab, we all went there when we heard that the police was coming. And so we could see what happened and how much the politicians lie about everything. On the other hand, that's it. It's a really tricky thing to talk about, and you know what, autonomy in that context, because the boundaries here is much more difficult to delimitate. Here again, I would have expected, mention some of the work that's been done by people like Dirk Helving and others, who tried to to see if they can build a physics of social crowds. And they have been quite successful, at least in some contexts. The 15 Emmys is a, I will say, it's a tricky thing, because on the one hand, happens in a situation where probably several historical processes collapse. You have all the media that allow, you know, to gather people in a very coherent way, in a very quick response time. Is a mixture of things happening. When you look at the networks that you have shown, you wonder, you give a good description of I think it's a good put, set of measures to characterize the what happens, well, what kind of statistical things happen in the system. But of course it remains open if the fluctuations that you observe are a mixture of the spread of rumors and information in social networks, which we know if you reach percolation, they can be very, very rapid, plus memory effects and decay effects. So maybe for me the only missing thing, and it's not a criticism, because it's a really difficult thing, would be more like, is it possible to make a minimal model of that beyond the measurements that you did? I think that the good part of your analysis is that it provides a very good context to think about if it's possible to make a model of that. So it's been interesting for me. I just wanted to say that it's easy to make a criticism, of course, that everything that is a very interesting case study. And I just wanted to mention another, I think, a relevant group of references that maybe it's not just you, so many people usually doesn't take much into account. It was in the late 80s and early 90s when Huberman and others developed this concept of computational ecology with agents participating in economical, social interactions, and all the potential for emergent behavior of that. And I think that maybe the kind of problem you have been addressing can be explored using the tools that they use in their studies. And so I have many other point questions that are not so relevant. But just say that I've been making some criticisms of particular things, but you have been very ambitious, and that's what I think is really relevant. That many theses that you can find out, the work has also been done very well, but there's no ambition beyond answering some simple question. So you've been trying to really go very far. It's difficult to succeed when you try that. But I enjoy reading the thesis, and I think that it's plenty of items to think about, and I hope that you others keep developing those ideas, and I think that's all. You guys have any other question?
I wouldn't mind following up something that you said. I also was also interested in the lack of an evolutionary dimension to the work, but that is maybe reflects the approach of some of the people that you're building on. There's a sort of central experiment that you use as an inspiration for a lot of your studies, where you have a little robot, but you decouple it from the environment and drive it with input from a different robot. So the experiment was done on kittens, and it's in a developmental context. And you, at one point in the thesis, you say, obviously, when the robot experiments that I'm doing don't have a developmental dimension, because the little robot that is being passively coupled, it's the first time that it's ever encountered that situation, and it doesn't get a chance to learn to cope with it. It just has to be it's subjected to the stream of input, and it tries to act, but nothing it does makes a difference to the stream of input. And you might imagine that the response, that the recordings that you take from that robot are going to be pathological. You know, it's in a pathological situation. So is there a variant of the experiment with the robots where you could bring back in, where you could make it a more fair comparison, where that the ability of the coupled robot to organize itself in some way so that the behavior that it exhibits is less, it could be less vulnerable to a kind of attack on the basis that you're just getting pathological behavior out of that robot.
So yeah, I think you could think or more intermediate position, but first I think that we tried some situations in which the agent was decoupled from the environment or was receiving just noise, and the passive decoupled agent was the closest we could obtain to the original agent, because the signal is exactly the same and it's
but its initial conditions are different, is that right?
Yeah, its initial conditions are different.
So it starts in a different initial condition in terms of its internal state, and then it receives a stream of inputs. So after the first input, because its initial condition is different, it's not trained with that set of inputs, and it veers off or whatever. It can't make use of them really, because it's not in the right coupling. So then there are experiments where you impose some noise, and I think in those situations, do you start from the same initial conditions, or do you still have two random initial conditions for the embedded and the decoupled robot?
Yeah, in that case, since you have noise and the noise is different from, in that case, the noise, there's just one source of noise and the initial conditions are different.
So the initial conditions are still different?
Yes. I think I could imagine that to test with more precision this, maybe it would be to see how very small changes in the initial conditions maybe change the behavior or not, or if there is a smaller distance between the initial conditions of the two, to test if there is difference between the two. But yes.
What would happen if your little robot was allowed to do this repeatedly? It's decoupled, but it encounters 100 decoupled exposures. So the homeostatic ability of the robot would that gradually, potentially it has the ability to organize itself in a way that copes better with the new decoupled state that it's in. Which is presumably what's happening to the kittens in the real experiment.
Right? Yeah, I think we made sure that the time of the simulation was much longer than the velocity of the synaptic mechanisms, and therefore I think the agent, after some attempts of trials, it's probably totally adapted to the pathological condition. And I think that to analyze something maybe more similar to the case of the development of the kittens, you will need to add maybe more other temporal scales of plasticity, maybe. Because the plasticity have different scales of plasticity, but they are constrained maybe to tens of trials. They cannot reach longer time scales, and maybe we have a exponential distribution of time scales of plasticity. Maybe there we can find more interesting distributions.
And related to the more directly to evolution, so this issue of asymmetry, that the agents have to be different from the environment. Well, that's one, the abiotic environment is not the product of evolution in the same way as the cognitive agent. But you don't really take advantage of that in your story, right? But, and in many of the accounts that are derived from treatments of autopoiesis or what has come after that, they don't seem to really want to take advantage of that evolutionary story to separate the autonomous world from the non-autonomous world. So why do you think that's a strategic choice, or I think at some point there is a sort of political story about why the notion of autopoiesis should not be carried over to look at social organizations. And I wonder whether there's also a kind of, maybe with a small p, political reason why you would want to bring evolution into your story about where your autonomy comes from.
Okay, yeah, I think that probably the main reason is that to reduce the complexity in the analysis of these models. We believe the robot has just three oscillators and the plasticity, it was quite complex to understand what was going on there with the nine-dimensional physics space. And I think that having a new vector of evolution there will increase greatly the complexity of how different forms of regulation and comparing different stages in evolution. I think it will be much richer, but also I think that
I guess what I'm getting at, so let's go back to that example of a woman cycling to work.
Yeah.
So let's imagine that she does every day, the decision that she makes is determined by the environment. You do the analysis and you find out, well, I thought she was actually making a decision, but it turns out once I understand the relevant environmental factors, those entirely determine what's going on. But from an evolutionary perspective, that's exactly the right thing to do. That's how she survives and ends up having children. So the asymmetry, just the brute statistical information theoretic asymmetry, is the wrong direction. The environment is in charge, but it's still the case that the evolutionary asymmetry is in the right direction. The weather has not evolved to defeat the woman's journey to work. It's just a fact of life about the environment. The woman's strategy is what has evolved to take advantage of, and maybe even if it's very closely correlated with it, that's a good thing. That's not a sign of being subjugated by the environment. It's a sign of being, fully aligned, fully mastering the variation.
Okay, yeah, that's very interesting. I think that, for example, here you're seeing genetic algorithms for this, and there you will find that it was very hard and seeking logic because we have tried to find an agent that doesn't just start to some fixed going on or a tractor and stays there. And I think that maybe it's interesting to think that we as an autonomous agents we evolve to our, because we need that agency in a particular type of environment. So I think that part of the complexity of taking into account an evolutionary perspective, it's in a modeling approach, is to maybe realistically simulate those environments, and it's maybe not easy to have environments that capture these requirements to act as an autonomous agent, and it would be a very interesting analysis to see what kind of environments we require to evolve autonomous behavior or this asymmetry between agent and environment. This increases enormously the complexity of the research, but I think it's a very interesting route of development of this kind of analysis. It would be interesting to test, for example, in this same simulation, what happens if you change the environment, or what happens if you have these longer synaptic values that allow us to maybe adapt to a changing environment.
Once again, I think that it's interesting material to think about. He was making his question, also thinking about how do, for example, uncolonies fit into this kind of binary. You can see them as very simple agents, they are dependent on the one hand to individual detection of environmental clues, but then collectively they can suppress the environment by using a pheromone field that amplifies some particular signals and then can get rid and ignore the rest of the environment too. Again, I'm thinking out loud. It's interesting to think what other things can you put in this diagram, and this diagram maybe has to be broadened in some way. But anyway, you see, it's clearly making you think about other ways of exploring ideas. Okay, so is anyone in the room who wants to say something and has a PhD? That's two conditions. No one? Okay. So